Hi, good evening, everybody. I'm Annie Daphne, an application engineer for Martin Lights, and I'm based out of Bangalore. So today I have along with me Mr. Edwin, Mr. Vinith, Mr. Sudhagar, and Mr. Amit, who are in the panel list. And you can drop in your questions at the QA tab while the session is going on so that we can take up some questions at the end of the session. So in our previous webinars, we had an overview of all the range of architectural as well as entertainment lights from Martin, and we also included creative LEDs. So today we'll go through the video processors from Martin, which are integral for converting your creative LEDs into for media facade applications. And we will also go through the integral power supply that is required, because these creative LEDs, you cannot directly connect them to your AC main. You need an integrated power supply for this particular application of media facade or any DMX applications. So before we get into the video processing and the power requirements and also their system connection, let's quickly just brush upon the products. So from the Martin portfolio for the creative LEDs, we have the PIX lines, which we've already gone through, which are linear rigid LED sticks designed for permanent installation. So they are IP66 rated, and we have three variants in this category. The exterior PIX line 10, 20, and 40. So depending on the pixel pitch, we rate them as 10, 20, or 40. So in the exterior PIX line 10, we have a 10 mm gap between the LEDs, and in 20 we have 20 mm, and in 40 we have 40 mm. And they come in 1 foot or 4 foot or even custom lengths. So they can be driven by P3, which is a video processor that we will be going through in the later slides, or you can also control them through the DMX or RDM protocol. So then we have the exterior dot HP, which are circular media facade products, which can also be used for perimeter lighting for high-rise buildings, and the examples for which we have already seen in the previous webinars. And here again, they consume 5 watts, and they come as either RGB or cold white LEDs, and can be driven through P3, RDM, or DMX protocols. Then we have the flexible string-based creative LED products, which are the VC dots, and they are in the form of a ribbon, as you can see in the image here. They come in three variants: VC dot 1, 4, and 9, and again are suitable for permanent outdoor installations because they're IP67 rated and can be driven through P3, RDM, or DMX protocol. And the advantage of the VC dots are that since they come in the shape of a ribbon, they can again take shape of the building and can be easily bent. And the last one is the VC grid and strips, which are IP20 rated and are suitable for indoor applications. And they come in the shape of either a grid, which you can see in the image here, the top image, and or in the form of strips, as you can see in the bottom image. And they come with various pixel pitches of 60 mm, 30 mm, 25, or 15 mm, which is nothing but the distance between the LEDs. Okay, so the video protocol from Martin is called the P3 controller. And the P3 controller is very powerful and ergonomic LED video controller from Martin, which is proprietary to Martin. So it can only control all the creative LED products from Martin and not, products of other manufacturers. And when I say ergonomic, it's very user-friendly and also easy to learn. And the biggest advantage, or why Martin leads the industry when it comes to P3 controllers, is because of the real-time visualization of the video mapping that happens through graphical user interface. So what I mean by this is, if you have a media facade application with a number of creative LED products which are installed on the facade, you can basically just replicate the same thing on your P3 software. So the P3 controller comes with the software for you for viewing and programming, etc. And you can lay out these fixtures as they are installed in the same sequence as they are installed in the facade. And then you create in a way, you're creating a big visual campus, a canvas, one visual canvas. And then what you do is you take the video from the media server or your laptop, and you simply just overlay it onto your layout, and automatically they start playing the video. So you're replicating your facade onto your screen. So that's the meaning of a real-time visualization of the video mapping. And because of this particular feature, the P3 controller is the most user-friendly controller in the market. And not only that, you can also scale and map your video according to the size of the layout. So as soon as you connect the creative LED fixtures to your controller, the P3 controller recognizes all the fixtures in the layout, and it will give you a pop-up on the screen. And then you simply have to drag these fixtures from the library and place it on the screen. So you need to be very careful while laying, because it needs to be in the same sequence that you have installed it on the facade. And based on the number of pixels they can control, we have four categories. The P350, which can control 1 lakh pixels, P3150, which can control up to 5 lakh pixels, and P3300, which can control up to 20 lakh pixels. And we also have a PC-based free software for beginners, which is called the P3PC. And that can control around 20,000 pixels. Okay. So this actually is an image, a snippet of the P3 software. And as you can see, all the red lines here are the pix lines, which have been laid out just as they are installed in the facade. And we have simply taken the video and we have overlaid it. So you can see the layer of the video that's playing on top of the pix lines. So now what happens is all the LEDs on the facade, which are within this red box, will start, turning on in red color on the facade itself. Similarly, all the LEDs which are within this red streak will also turn on and show in red on the facade, and the remaining portions will be in black, and or they will be turned off. So similarly, as the video moves, the facade will also respond in the same way, with just a delay of two frames. So this is a basic configuration of the P3 controller for the Creative LED products. And the P3 controller can accept video signals from the media server, or it could be a simple laptop setup as well. And it can accept it in the format of DVI, HDMI, or 3G SDI. And then the video signal goes on to the power ports. So like I said previously, these Creative LED products, they cannot be directly connected to the AC mains. So we need something called the power port, which combines the AC power mains as well as the video signal, and sends this hybrid data into the Creative LED products. So we have the gigabit Ethernet switch, which will basically distribute the video signal to the power port for Creative LED products. Or in instances where you have P3 enabled entertainment products, like we have mentioned here, Mac Aura, PXL, or Mac Allure, or Martin's Video Atomic Dot, which are in the entertainment segment, you can still control them through the P3 controller. So since these products, which are the entertainment products, they can be directly connected to the AC main, so we don't need a hybrid power to go to them. We just need the video signal. So we have an unmanned switch to distribute the video signal to the different products. So this is moving on to the P350. This is the most affordable and compact LED video controller from Martin. And any P3 controller, be it the 50 or 150 or 300, they have two capacities or two limits depending on which we have to design them. So the first one is the pixel limit. So the P350 can control up to 1 lakh pixels. So this limit is actually set by the video processing engine that comes with the P3 controller. And you can again expand it by adding more P350s to the network if your installation is more than 1 lakh pixels. Second limit is the fixture capacity. So this is nothing but the total number of fixtures that you can load onto the P3 controller, and that is defined or set by the GUI processing engine. So the P350 has a maximum fixture capacity of 2000 fixtures. And again, this is also expandable by using more P350s to the network. So anytime you actually design a system, we need to choose products. And after we choose the products, we need to see for this particular product, which limit exceeds first. So some for some products the fixture limit comes before the pixel limit, and for some products the pixel limit comes before the fixture limit. Now, for example, if you're using the Pixline 40, the 4 foot version, this fixture has 32 pixels on the fixture, and so when you load, when you're connecting 2,000 fixtures to this P350, you're still consuming only 64,000 pixels. So in this example, the fixture limit is exceeding or comes before the pixel limit. Whereas if you're using a exterior Pixline 10 4 foot version, there are 128 pixels on this fixture. So when you're just connecting 781 fixtures, you've already reached the pixel limit. So you cannot load it up to 2000. So we most of the fixtures like Pixlines or exterior.hps and VC dots, the fixture limit always comes before the pixel limit, except in case of Pixline 10 and 20, where the pixel limit comes first, especially with the P350, because it can control only 1 lakh pixels. And what Martin has done is they have formulated or calculated all the maximum number of fixtures that you can load on to the controller, including the pixel limits. And they have formulated a table which is there in the website. You can always have a look at it while designing the system. And the P350 can accept DVI-D inputs of up to 1920 into 1080 resolution. And they also have a color resolution of 16 bits per color, so which means 48 bits per pixel, because they are RGB LEDs. And the latency or the delay between the first panel that's installed on the facade to the last panel that's installed on the facade is zero, which means there's no delay in the video that's video signal to pass on to the last panel. And all of the products or fixtures that are connected to the system will send back their status so that we can easily monitor them from the screen. And also, the P3 controller can be connected to your DMX lighting console, or they can be connected to an ArcNet console. And you can do various functions like color changing or intensity changing while the video is playing. So what this means is usually if you're using the P3 controller, you can only do either video changing or color changing, but you cannot do both at the time. So when you're connecting them to a lighting console, you can play the video as well as do color changing. So an example of it is given in the next slide. So here you see that the P3 controller is connected to your lighting console through ArcNet. So ArcNet has a slight edge over DMX, because DMX has only 4 universes, whereas ArcNet you can expand up to 32 universes. And as you can see, while the video is playing in the background, you can also change the color using the DMX protocol. And what happens is the lighting console, from the lighting console, you can actually patch or address the P3 controller as a whole. So what happens, all the fixtures which are connected to the P3 controller will automatically get addressed onto the lighting console as well. So here again, he's changed the color from cyan to magenta. And not only the entire installation, you can also do segment-wise color changing because you're connecting to the lighting console. And you can see that the video is also being played in the background. So that's the advantage of connecting them to a lighting console. So in addition to color changing, you can do intensity changing. You can also black out or freeze the video and the colors also. So next is the P3150, which is a mid-range video processor. And in addition to doing, to all the features that are there in the P350, this can control up to 5 lakh pixels. But the fixture capacity is still 2000 because of the limit of the graphical user interface. This is the back panel of the P350 and the 150. They are alike. So first we have the DMX in and the DMX through slots to connect to the lighting console. And then we have the P3 out, which is an Ethernet slot to connect to the power port, which is in turn connected to the creative LEDs. Then we have the digital video input, which is the DVI-D in, which is the input from the media server or the laptop to send in the video signal. Then we have the DVI-D through. This is for daisy chaining other P3 controllers in the network. And Then we have the USB port and the display port to connect your mouse, keyboard, or your monitor to see the software. And then we have the MGMT or the eDMX Ethernet slot. So eDMX is for ARPANET or SACN connection, where you want to increase the universes while controlling from the lighting console, or you want to connect some other entertainment products. And the management slot has network has several functions. So the first one is communication with the internal web server to get all the status reports of the products connected to the system. Or second, you can also use it for remote monitoring. So in case a client is not sitting in the same location, then through this connection, he can actually monitor the entire system from his computer. And the third one is you can connect it to a motion control source like a Kinesis K2 or a Tate Navigator. So this is very useful when you want the lights to react as per movement of the people in that particular area. So what they will do is, as people are passing by, this motion control source, which could be a Kinesis or a Tate Navigator, will recognize people moving, and it will depending on how the program is written on that source, it will the light will change according to it. So a very good example of the motion control is the Saxo Bank in Denmark, where all the as you can see, the ceiling, it has an installation of VC dots, and as people are moving in the corridor, the light also follows them. And another user interface that they've incorporated in this project is, if any one of these meeting rooms are occupied, then the VC dots, which are above the room, will turn red. So that's again all done using the motion control software, which can be integrated with the P3 controller. Okay. So I had also mentioned about this daisy chaining that can happen from one P3 network to the other P3 network. So there are two scenarios where this might be needed. So first scenario is if you have a very large installation, or you have a very large campus where there are two installations in different locations, then and you want to play the same video on both the locations, and you have only one media server, then you can simply send the video signal to the first P3 controller, and then you can daisy chain the media signal to the second P3 controller, so the same video will go there. The second scenario is when you have a very large installation, and the limit of the first P3 controller has already been exceeded, and you have to use a second P3 controller, then you can use this. So an example of that, I'll just explain the second scenario using an example. Now, if you have a facade where you have to use 4,000 PIX lines, and you want a single video to play on it, so in the sense on across the 4,000 pixels, you want it to look like a single video screen, then what you can do is with the P3 controller 50, you can only load up to 2,000 fixtures. So you're going to need two P3 controllers. So you can divide the facade into two, and the P3 controller A can control half of the fixtures, and the P3 controller B can control the second half of the fixtures. Okay, so then what you do is you daisy chain the media signal. So the same video will go to P3 controller A as well as B. But when you're doing the video mapping on the screen, you need to be very careful. And how you got to do is, the first half of the fixtures need to be placed in the left-hand portion of the video, and on the second controller, the second half of the fixtures need to be placed on the right-hand edge of the video. So what happens is these two will merge together on the facade, and you will see it as a single video. So let's take a picture also to explain it better. So this is not the exact, I'm just taking it for reference here. So for example, if this entire installation had 4,000 pixel lines, like I explained in the previous slide, so what you do is the P3 controller A can control 2,000 fixtures, which are within the yellow box, and the P3 controller B can control the other 2,000 fixtures, which are within the green box. So what you do is the video will be as an entire single video. So you have to place the fixtures on the left-hand side of the screen or your P3 controller software on the first controller, and on the second controller monitor, you have to place all the PIX lines on the second edge of the video. So you need to have a good pair of eyes to see where exactly to stop the first set of PIX lines and where to start the second set of PIX lines. So the last one is the P3300, which is a very powerful P3 controller and can drive up to 20 lakh pixels. And so which means it gives us more for pictures like pixel lines 10, where the P350 would have already exceeded the pixel limit. You can use it on the P3300 or even 150 for the matter. And the fixture capacity is still 2000 fixtures. And in addition to having a DVI-D input, it can also accept it also has two slots for 3G SDI input and also analog input. And in addition, it also has a dedicated bi-level and tri-level sync input for Genlock. So if you want to sync two videos, then you can use it and also link, lock the sync ratio so that there's no mismatch in playing the videos. And you can also connect them to a DMX or an ARCnet protocol. And they have all the features of the other two P3 controllers. So this is the back panel of the P3300, and you can see that there are some additional slots here. So in the P350 and 150, we only had one Ethernet slot, which should be used for both management and eDMX, which means at any point of time, you could have used only one feature. But here, since we have two dedicated slots, one for management and one for eDMX, you can use both the features at the same time. And then we have USB ports, and we have the DVI-D or the 3G SDI and analog inputs, as well as DVI-D analog and SDI outputs for daisy chaining. And we have the DMX in and through, which can be connected to the lighting console. And instead of just one P3 out, which goes to the power port, we have four numbers of P3 out. So you can connect it to four different power port networks, or you could use one for power port and the rest for entertainment lights as well. So then moving on to the power port. So like I said, the Creative LED products cannot be directly connected to the AC mains, and we need an integral power supply which will convert the AC power into 48 volt DC. And so we have the power ports. And not only that, the power port will also take the video signal from the P3 controller, and it will take the AC supply from the AC mains, and it will combine both of them and send a hybrid output to the Creative LEDs. So in this way, you don't have to use two runs of cables, one for data and one for power. You can just have one hybrid cable, which is also of Martin's, and we call them BBD cables. And power ports, we have power port 1500, then power port 1000 IP rental. So it's IP because it's IP65 rated and can be used for rental applications. Now, because they are IP65, they cannot be used for permanent installations. So for that, we have the power port, P3 power port, IP66 rated, so which is called IP install. Then for DMX applications where you don't want to do any video playing videos on the, you just want to do simple changing, then you can use the P3 controller system itself and use the DMX power port, which will just give power to the Creative LEDs, and it will take the DMX signal from the lighting console and directly give it to the products. Or we also have the Martin IP66 rated PSU, which can be installed outside. So the power port 1500 and the DMX power port 375 can be used inside the building. They cannot be installed outside. Okay. So this is the system configuration or the system connection of the P3 power port 1500. So this power port will take the video signal from the P3 controller. It'll also take the AC power from the socket, and it'll combine it and give a steady hybrid power to the Creative LED products. So in this example, I've taken PIX lines and to set up and can be easily recognized by the P3 controller. And they have four outputs. So to each power port, you can connect four chains of Creative LED products. And in addition to that, these power ports can also be daisy chained. So you can loop them in and out to connect more than one chain, more than four chains to your network. They can either be wall mounted, truss, or rack mounted. And they can be located 50 meters away from the Creative products, which means that this distance from the power port output to the first product in the chain can be 50 meters away. So you can keep the power port inside also, provided they're less than 50 meters. So this again is the back panel, and as you can see, there are two P3 in and through Ethernet sockets. So the in is to accept the video signal from the P3 controller, and through is to daisy chain the power ports. And there are four outputs to connect to the Creative LED products. And these are four pin XLR connectors. Okay, so like we had mentioned in the previous webinars, now all these Creative LED products, they can be connected in chains. And there is again a maximum length of fixtures that you can connect. And that is because of the limit of these power ports. So this is a table denoting the maximum number of fixtures that can be connected to every output of the power port. So if you take an example of the exterior PIX line 40, then you can connect 31 fixtures in one single output. So which means since every power port has four outputs, you can connect four chains, each containing 31 numbers. Similarly, an example of products that you can connect to one output of VXC.HP or VC dots. Again, the entire range of products is given in the manual. I've just taken a snippet of one line. So then we are moving on to the power rental. So this is IP65 rated and used in for rental applications where you just need to use a product for maybe 2 or 3 hours and then remove it from the truss. So again, they can be wall mounted truss or rack mounted, and they're used to run rental products like Video Septron or Exterior Dotrons. And here again, they have the P3 input and through for daisy chaining, and four outputs to connect to the Creative LEDs. So for permanent installation purposes, we have the PowerPort 1000IP installed, which is IP66 rated and can be used to connect PIX lines, exterior dots, and VC dots. So this is the capacity of the PowerPort IP, both IP rental as well as IP install. And it's a little less when compared to the PowerPort 1500. So here you can connect a maximum of 21 numbers of exterior PIX line 40 in one chain. So for DMX applications where you don't need to run videos, you just want to do color changing on the Creative LED products, and you don't need to have the P3 controller. So you can directly take the DMX signal from the lighting console, and you can take the AC mains power from your socket, and it'll combine them and give it to the Creative LEDs. So for that purpose, we have the DMX in, which is from the lighting console, and through if you want to connect other systems to the network. And then we have the out, which is connected to the Creative LEDs. Denoting the number of chains that you can connect when you're designing. So last one is the Martin IP66 PSU. So here, this is an external, just an external driver that you can use. So here again, you can take the DMX signal from the lighting console, and the AC power will be supplied from the AC mains, and the PSU will just convert the AC to DC. Now to combine both, to send hybrid cables, we have something called the Y cable, which is from Martin, which will combine the DMX and the power signal and send the hybrid signals to the Creative LED products. So because they're IP66 rated, you can install them outside and they can be wall mounted. So you can directly, you know, mount them on the surface, building facade. And you need to maintain a distance of less than 50 meters from this Martin PSU to your first Creative LED product in the chain. So this is the system connection diagram for the DMX applications. Where you can either use a Martin IP66 PSU, or you could even use any other external driver. It can be any external driver. So this is the hybrid DC cable, which I was talking about, which is from Martin. So this particular cable is used to combine the DMX signal and the DC power output to send it to the any creative products. So when you're using these creative LED products in DMX applications, you need to be you need to take care of as to what mode you want to plate them in. So any a creative LED product has four modes. So the first one is RGB mode, where you just want to do RGB, red, green, and blue color changing. And the second mode is called the basic mode, where you can also change, you know, do white combination when you combine all the RGB colors. And the third mode is called the segment mode. So in this mode, you have some pre-programmed macros through which you can do different patterns like rainbow effect or pulley siren effect or color combinations. Like on the same fixture, you can do different colors like red, blue, or blue green combinations. And the last one is called the pixel mode, where you can individually change the color of each of the LEDs on the fixture. So that again consumes a lot of DMX channels. So depending on choose, the number of channels that you're consuming will also vary. So you need to be careful as to what how many universes your console has. Okay, so with this, we come to the end of the power and processing for the Creative LED products. And any questions or queries regarding to you know, regarding this particular topic, you can always reach out to Ms. Shilpi, Mr. Vinith, Mr. Edwin, or myself. Amit, are there any questions that we can take up?
So there is one question which has been asked by Muhammad Azwar. He basically is asking, can you tell me what is the difference between RGB and RGBA?
Okay, so RGBA is more used in the entertainment or stage lighting applications, where because getting the color amber is very difficult, using the combining of RGB, we have separate amber LEDs. So we have individual red, green, blue, as well as amber LEDs. So again, very predominantly used in the entertainment lighting segment. Whereas for facade lighting, we just have RGB LEDs, which can do red, blue, green color changing. And when you mix either of these two LEDs, you're going to get different combinations of secondary colors.
Great. Thank you so much. Next question we have from Mr. Abrar. He's asking, so we don't have a normal RJ45 as a management port. So I guess he is wanting to check whether it's a control port or not.
No, actually, Edwin, would you like to take up this question? Because
So we have two protocol actually here. One is ATNET and ASCN. So the connector is RJ45, but the cable we use is here is CAT5 and CAT6 cables.
Okay.
Great. Thanks for that, Edwin. There's another question again from Mr. Abrar. He's asking, is it necessary that both the models should be the same, or can we use one P3050 and one P3150?
We could use, but you know, because of the ease in installation and ease in, you know, patching, then we always recommend to use the same type. If you're using P350, it's always recommended to go with other P3 systems in the same network, because that being said, again, they have the same fixture capacity and pixel capacity, so controlling them will be much easier.
Great, thank you. I hope this answer helps, Mr. Abrar. Then Ritam Das is asking, could you describe daisy chaining a bit more elaborately?
Okay, so what daisy chaining means in simple terms is just looping them. So with the P3 controller, what you can do is the video signal, because you cannot have two different media servers. Media servers are very costly. When you have a very large installation, and you have only one media server in your for your campus or your installation, then you can basically send the same video to more than one P3 controller. So that's called daisy chaining, wherein I just connect the media server to the first P3 controller system in the network, and then I'm looping the other rest of the P3 controller systems. So I don't need a individual connection from the media server to every P3 controller. From the first, it will go on to the consecutive P3 controllers. I hope
Great.
That answered this question.
Yes, I hope you'll be happy to know this.
Yeah, it's basically like connecting them in series. Yeah.
Okay. Great. Next question is from Sumit Bhagat. He's asking, when using Pixline for video applications, what is the implication in terms of the weaving distance? Since we have a 10, 20 and a 40 mm spacing in the tabs that we use.
Correct. So basically, as the distance between or the pixel pitch increases, you just have to multiply it into 10 meters to go away from the building. So if you have a narrower pixel pitch, that means your minimum viewing distance can be much lesser in order to see a non-pixelated video. And if your pixel pitch is 20 meters, then you need to go further away from the building to see a non-pixelated video. But that being said, you cannot take the literal, LED video screen for this kind of calculation, because our brain is so intelligent that even if the minimum viewing distance is not the offset that they say that we should maintain, we can connect the dots very easily. So our brain can connect the dots very easily and still view it as a continuous single video instead of seeing them as individual pixels.
Great, great. Next question that we have is in terms of the distance on the power ports. So Nanak is asking whether is there a limitation in terms of the distance for installing two power ports?
So actually, the distance between the power ports, since they are Cat5 cables, you can maintain the general thumb rule is to have a giga maintain a distance of 50 meters or less than that. So to overcome this installation where you have farther power ports more than 50 meters, we have this unmanned gigabit switch, Ethernet switch, which will help in the distributing of the video signal.
Okay, great. This question, I guess you've answered, but I'll still repeat it here. So Abrar again is asking further to his questions earlier, that does daisy chaining means that connections of devices done in a series, which I guess you elaborated and mentioned that it's in a series.
Yeah.
Sumit is further asking, does it relate to 10 mm spacing for weaving distance closer to screen and 40 mm for weaving distance, away from the screen? So I guess that is what you just elaborated.
Yeah, 40 mm. Yeah, yeah.
So when you are, let's say, using a 10 mm thing, you basically can weave it from closer, to the surface area. And if it's a 40 mm thing, the weaving distance naturally increases.
Correct. And again, this viewing distance is just the minimum offset that is main that you need to maintain if you want to see a nice, clear, non-pixelated video.
Great, great, great. I'm sure this is going to help people understand as to what, what product to use for what viewing distance that they have. Going further, there's a question from Vinu. Vinu is asking, can you explain the motion control feature of the controller a bit more?
Okay, so what this motion controller basically, just like our motion sensors that are there, like occupancy sensors that these internal general lighting comes with, what the this particular software, which is the Kinesis K2 or Tate Navigator, they will detect people moving. And we need to program on the this particular software as to how the lights have to react when people are moving. Now, for example, in that Saxo Bank picture that I showed, when the people are actually walking on the corridor, the color will change and there will be a row of lights which get activated as people are moving. So that particular row of light will keep changing to a different color. So when you move across the room, it'll be like someone is following you but on the ceiling. That's all. So how this does is this particular software will send the command, or it will send the trigger signal to your P3 controller, which in turn will change the color of that particular row of light or anything, any system. I'm just telling in terms of row of light with respect to the Saxo Bank example. But however you have programmed the motion control software and the P3 controller software to communicate, they will communicate and they will do the P3 controller will in turn do the change that needs to happen. So another example is the head office in Denmark, which has a nice interactive media facade, where generally, the facade will be in one color, but if a cycle or a car passes by, immediately the color will change. So it just gives a kind of a new experience to people who are passing by. So how this color change happened is the Kinesis software actually detected a car passing by, and it will send the trigger signal to the P3 controller. And in turn, the P3 controller will send the command to the Creative LED products or the VC dots to change the color. And another example is the the Danish Federation industry, which again the YouTube video is there in Martin professional page, and here in that particular example, people are given a an app in the mobile phone where if you just draw some patterns on the mobile phone, then that particular pattern is actually replicated on the facade. So here again we have the software which is actually talking through the mobile phone platform to the P3 controller, and the P3 controller sends the command for the color changing or the pattern changing.
Fantastic. I guess to further add on to what Annie just mentioned, everybody who's there on this particular webinar, what you could do is you could probably visit the YouTube page of Martin. So it basically goes as Martin Professional. You will see our official logo icon there, and you will be able to see a lot of videos, and especially the one that mentioned about for the Danish Federation of the Danish Confederation of the Industry. So that is where you will get to see as to how exactly the system has been deployed and what all you can do. So make sure you visit that page, and probably you can subscribe or you can have a look at the videos that are there. You get a fair bit of an idea of what you can probably install. Thanks Annie for this elaborate explanation. Going further, there's a question that we have in terms of the switch that we need to use, whether it needs to be managed or unmanaged.
You could use both actually, so it is acceptable. It just depends on the kind of control that you need to have, whether you want it to be a monitored switch or an unmanaged switch.
Great. The next question is Mohammed Azwar again. He's asking, he says most devices use 48 volt DC, which is very similar to the voltage that's used in audio consoles, but there it is known as phantom power. And why is that so?
I'm sorry, I didn't understand the question.
Okay. His point that he's trying to ask is most products that we have, especially the lighting products, they get power from a 48 volt DC.
Correct.
And he
so
says
here
that
again,
is a...
Go ahead.
You can explain that. I'll ask the second part later.
Okay, so here again, these power port, actually the job of the power port is to convert the AC power into a 48 volt DC. But why we have a power port instead of just using any driver for the video applications is because otherwise what you would need is you would need a separate power cable and a separate Ethernet or Cat5 cable to send the video signal. So we are overcoming that by using a power port which has the ability to combine this video signal and your AC power main, and the final output, which is in the hybrid cable, would be a DC 48 volt DC and a video signal which is going to the PIX lines. And I hope that was his, I hope that was his question and I answered it. I'm not sure because.
Yes. I mean, your explanation is correct. Now, his second part is the same voltage per se is used in microphones. I mean, especially when you're talking about audio consoles,
Okay.
It's basically used in microphones to power certain microphones, and there it is known as phantom power. So basically, in the microphone world, it's only to ensure that the microphone gets the necessary power to sort of get your circuitry, the electronic circuitry activated. So that's about it. So it's the same power, yes, but in the audio world, it's called as phantom power, whereas here it is simply called as 48 volt DC.
Yes.
So thanks for that. Another question again from Mohammed Azwar is, he is asking, can you give an indication about how is pixel calculated? Is there a formula for that?
So the pixel in terms of the Creative LED products is nothing but the number of LEDs on the particular product. So let me just move to that PIX line. Yeah, so if you look closely on this first PIX line here with the clear diffuser, there are LEDs actually placed linearly. So each of these LEDs are called pixels in the creative. So it's not literal, not the same pixel meaning as in a video application. So here when I say pixel, it's nothing but the number of LEDs on this particular product. So the pixel pitch is nothing but the distance between the LEDs. So in the exterior PIX line 10, we have 128 pixels on the longer, which is a 4-foot version. So that means that's the reason there is you calculate based on how many features can be connected to the V3 controller depending on the particular limit of that P3 controller.
Okay, great. I'm sure it is going to help.
Amit, actually, we have pixel chat as well for each controller. So you not worry about the calculation. So you can get to that chat and all the fixtures, what if the pixel is consumed, you get a chat. So for each controller.
So correct. So this... Yeah, right. Thanks, Edwin. So this is the chart. So here what Martin has done is in order for us to, you know, to order to avoid we getting confused, they have already formulated a chart based on the fixtures, pixel count and the fixture limit of the particular controller. And they have come up with a table which will clearly tell you if you're using this P3 controller, and if you're using this fixture, then this is the maximum number of fixtures that you can control to this to that particular P3 controller.
Okay, great. Cool. So with that, we come to the last question, which basically is, I guess, in continuation with the motion control feature that you explained about the P3. So the question goes as, so with motion control, can we have a video moving along with the motion as well?
Yes, we can. So what happens is, now because this particular, if I'm talking about any media server again, you can load in many videos to the same P3 controller, and maybe the trigger can be, or the command from the Kinesis could be to change the video when a particular person is moving, or it could simply be change the color when a particular person is moving. So it just depends on your application and the creativity that you want to use with respect to that particular installation.
So I guess with that, we've come to the end of the questions that have been put up. So you would want to say a closing note before we sort of, do the closing pitch?
So I guess that's it.
Yeah. So for everybody's reference, I guess in the regular sequence that we followed, I guess today's webinar will happen to be the last that we are doing. We will keep you guys posted on the further webinars that Harman will post up, and whatever you are planning. In case you guys would like to hear from us and know or learn about some particular topic, you can always write into us. You have the mail IDs here on your screen now, and you can basically write to any of these team members irrespective of what product line you want to know about, and we will take the constructive feedback and probably try to build a webinar on that. So with all that, I would thank everyone. Thanks, Annie, for this wonderful session. Thank you, Shilpi, Vineet, as well as Edwin, for helping with the Q&A sessions, as well as answering questions to people on the chat and the Q&A window. At the same time, I'd like to thank each and every one of you on behalf of the entire team for participating and attending these webinars with such enthusiasm. So thank you once again. So please stay safe and take care of yourself. Follow all the guidelines that the government gives you and ensure that your health is good.
Yeah.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody. Stay safe. Have a nice weekend.